everybody. Hello, welcome.
Dear me.
Quite a bit of drawing today, mainly in the midsection. I've got nothing drawn in the front. Plenty drawn in the middle. So I'll give you 10-15 minutes to get that sketched out, and I'll make a soggy jacky a drink. Let's get some birdsong on. It's rather wet today, but very warm. So you put a lot of plastic on and you get very sweaty as well. One of those days today. We'll chat through the colours in a minute. As I said in the post, I'm using green grey paper. I seem to favour it more for landscapes, just because it's a bit easier. What's that?
Picture.
It is a lovely picture. Cotswold lavenders. It's very nice. Quite a few colours today, but that's just because of the vibrancy of the lavender. Hopefully I can get that done. I'll give it to about 1:45 to draw it out. got black and white on there, but you probably don't need much black. Just a useful colour for darkening in gouache. So black and white, ultramarine and crimson, cadmium yellow and lemon yellow. We're going to try and make our browns using those colours today. Just for a change, something different. So I've just roughly marked out where the windows and everything are for this cottage. The cottage is kind of the focal, and I don't know about, because we've got the lavender going right the way across. I've missed off a bit of tree or something. You know what, I'm just going to do that and then a tree there. It stands out enough, doesn't it, the pencil. You can just about see it. I think a couple more minutes will do. If you need more time and you're watching an art stream, you can always give it a pause until you've finished sketching. You can make the clouds a bit purplish as well. Not too purple, but on my printout they've come out quite purple. A little bit. So you can use similar tones in the sky to the lavender to balance it out, really. Right, I'm gonna go with a small flat brush. I don't tend to use big brushes with gouache. I did say I was gonna start doing them on A5, didn't I? But then I haven't. So we go with a bit of white. And a tiny little bit of cadmium yellow. I want this to be fairly opaque as we get to the lower part of the sky. Because as we know, it dries in a very different way . Should go a little bit more yellowish, hopefully, as we progress and it dries. I might add a little bit more cad yellow. It's just cad yellow and white. let that dry a little bit more. So I can see exactly what tone it's going. I don't want too much moisture because I am using card. It's the Clairefontaine paint on paper in verdigris as usual for landscapes. And you can't see it possibly, but I can, that I've got some cockles in my paper already. Go with a little bit of sky before we put the clouds on, which is mainly ultramarine and a little bit of white. On the upper right section, this might go a little bit darker than I hope. I have got purple paint in my palette and I might use that. Save using up all my other colour. And the purple is dioxazine violet, which is basically the same colour as you'd get with ultramarine and crimson. It's a bright purple. So we've got to get lots of things to dry. Just show you what that purple looks like. You see, that's the equivalent of if I was mixing ultramarine and crimson together. I'll add a little bit of white to that because I want a few wispier bits. Still using that same flat brush actually, because why not? It'll dull down a little bit as it picks up and wets some of that yellow, because that's what I like about gouache, is that it will blend with the colours that are already on there with a damp brush if you just keep working at it a little bit, which is really, really nice. I'm over purpling, if that's a word, but it is now, just decided. And that aim is to really balance. I might put a bit more ultramarine in with my mix. Oh, that's a nice colour, isn't it? Just to have a few different colours in there. You know, I like a nice sky. I'm actually, in a weird way, toning the purple into the green, because the green ends up going, it's fascinating when you do landscapes on green paper, because it almost turns grey when you least expect it. Maybe a bit more white. soft and light will work really nicely with these tones and work beautifully with the lavender. But we'll go a little bit darker with some of those clouds and a bit bluer, but we'll wait a minute, we'll let it dry first, and I'll have a sip of some tea. It's hard to keep everything looking random, so that's why I keep stopping to interrupt the flow, because if I carry on, what I'll do is I'll end up just repeating the same shapes and the same textures, and then I'll be annoyed because I'll go, well, that doesn't look very random. Right, let's go with a bit more ultramarine in with my purple. Still a bit of white in there. Now, weirdly, I am going to dull it down with a little bit of cadmium yellow. So as long as it's not too blue, you can do that. If it goes green, that's your indicator to go, there's too much blue in this. And then if it goes green, that's where you add a bit more red. I'm just stabbing and wobbling my brush around. A darky purple grey. I might go a bit darker even more than this. I don't know really. It all depends what it'll look like when it's actually dry to how much I add or not. Just want to create layers, you see. Let's go with a bit more purple, more blue, and a bit of yellow for dark. Too much yellow and it'll go brown or green, so do really think and look. Also, if you're working on card, you'll find it beneficial to keep stopping and allowing the card to dry. Otherwise you'll get little balls appear, which will be your paper. That's kind of nice muted tones. We'll see what that looks like as it dries, I think. I think it'll be all right. I don't think I'll need to add anything else to that. Some Jubilee bits for it as well. Because I put all the other stuff out, but the Jubilee stuff is still in the box. Do you know? Have you seen where I put all the stuff?
No.
Okay, I'll have to show you in a minute. Go with a little bit of lemon yellow and ultramarine, mainly lemon yellow. There's a tiny slither of green in between the fields there, Although, to be honest, you know what? Let's just block this in with lemon yellow and a little bit of ultramarine. Behind the houses. It's always good to block in. I like blocking in. It's one of my favourite things because it makes me think I've done far much more than I have. And I can lighten this if I need to, or darken it with more yellow or anything. We'll see how it goes. It's the video tends to pick up the colours more strongly. Everything's all about letting it dry. Everything's let it dry, let it dry. Something like that anyway. Trees, if you notice, are really quite dark in the background, and I'll probably use a small detail brush for that. So we need a nice start. Let's find my number one round brush. Or number two round brush, doesn't really matter. And we'll go with a nice dark green, and we can make that from cadmium yellow and ultramarine. You'll need quite a substantial amount of this. Oh, I've just used the wrong colour. I've made brown look out of purple. I don't know why I went to purple. Because clearly you can see it doesn't make a colour that we want to use yet. Rather silly of me. It's rather silly of me. What not to do? Yeah, that's very true. I did it on purpose, you see. Sadly, can't correct that error. But I'll probably use that brown. I'll show you how to use the brown that we've made up by mistake and make it on purpose. Right, so we'll go with some... annoyingly, I've stored this number two brush badly and it's lost its point. Feels rather like me. doing a few dotty bits. You know, you can fill in large areas, and then when you get into the foliage, do dots. What's weird about this composition is the way that the photograph is taken is the roof line is exactly level with the line of the fields, so it looks a little bit odd. If you got like a stipply brush, you could stipple with this if you didn't fancy doing dots. But sometimes doing the dots is quite mindful because you can be very absorbed in the dotting. Try and make it random when you're doing these sort of things. I know that's easier said than done, and you might be thinking, oh, I've made it random. But then actually, you look again and you go, oh, that's not random at all. In fact, we can dilute this a little bit to create the tractor furrows. Well, they're not furrows, I suppose they're the tractor lines though, from when the fields were planted. It just helped give it a little bit of depth and perspective, I suppose. Doing it more as a dotted line. Doesn't feel as blocked or linear. It just helps with a little bit of distance and depth, doesn't it? So we're half an hour in. You want to keep your background fairly simple in a way, because it's going to detract from the foreground, and if you do too much detail in the background, then unfortunately and sadly for you, you're going to have to do even more detail in the foreground. So the foreground lavender will have to be almost photographic if you're not careful, so just bear that in mind. Don't overly complicate your mid-ground or your background. We're going to use that same sort of green tone the dark green for the bushes to the side and behind the building. Because then if we do that, then we can put the building in front. So we're not leaving gaps. What we don't want is to have little thin gaps where we've missed things out, and it starts to look like a paint by numbers then. We're not after that today. So it'd still be the dark green that we use. Let's go and mix up. I'm probably going to use my 1/8 inch brush, because you know I love that one. And I'll start with cad yellow and ultramarine. Because right behind here, the house, right behind this bit. So I'm going to block it in with the flat. And then add me dots afterwards. It doesn't have to be a perfect line either, does it? You know. We'll add some highlights to this as well, and I can show you how to do that shortly, but like that. So I've blocked that in quite quickly with the flat, and then use the little round brush, the detail brush, for some foliage. Now the light is quite tricky. I think, judging from the shadows, and this has been taken on a lunchtime, which as you know is my least favourite time to see a photograph, because it's boring. The light is directly ahead. And so that means that, directly above, sorry, not ahead, directly above. And having it directly above means all the shadows are really short. The chimney shadows are really short in this. In fact, it's the more I'm looking at it, I thought they were long chimneys, but it's not. It's it's a chimney, and the top of the roof line is the bottom of the chimney line, but the shadows are what is making it even longer. So it's a slightly different scene to what I first thought at 8 o'clock this morning when I revisited my lesson plans. So we'll let that dry for a sec, and then we'll add some lemony yellow highlights on. If we can get out without using any black, I will, but I think they'll definitely be needed in the window. Going with the number 2 round, lemon yellow and ultramarine this time, just for do a few dabby bits highlights on the leaves. This time it's more lemon and less blue. The previous green was more blue. And this way, you see, you can create extra bits of foliage, and it is just dots, to be honest. I can't pretend it's anything else. And you think of clusters of branches and foliage, so you're not just doing an outline. You might have one bit that's just a little bit lighter. As a child growing up watching the original Wombles animation in the 1980s, they had trees in the scene that were painted, and it's always made me think like that. There were sort of like little, you know, that I'm gonna say flash bang wow, you know, the little zigzaggy shapes for a tree, and then there'd be some smaller areas, similar shapes stuck on and brought forward. I'm probably not making any sense at all, and it's always made me think. I think Bob the Builder was a bit like that as well when my nephews used to watch him. I'll have to draw you what I mean, because it makes no sense. I'm aware of that. At least I know when I'm not making any sense to you. Maybe a few little bright spots of yellow. Makes it stand out. I'm trying to find a scrap bit of paper that I can show you what on earth I'm on about. I'll just do it on here very quickly. If I can find my pen, that's gone as well now. Honestly, I'll do it in black marker. So you got like a tree like that. Maybe it was like that. And then you've got clusters of smaller branches that stuck out. So it looked more like a 3D tree whilst also being two-dimensional. Very clever, but it's always made me think of trees having bits of branches coming out of it somewhat. Again, you don't want to go too crazy with this because you're going to have to put more detail in everything else if you do. If at all possible, it would be good to finish this mid-ground so we can work on the foreground for the second half. So that I'm hoping we can get that cottage done in the next 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes. We want a creamy colour, which is going to be white. This is for the walls, and they're in shadow. White, a little bit of cad yellow, and I'm going to put in some purple in there, just a little bit of my purple sky mix, just to dull it down. And I don't mind if this is actually quite runny. It's weird, isn't it? It kind of looks darker. Even though we're using white. More purple. I can just get the hint of the side of the cottage. There. It will look lighter when all the other colours are on. It's one of those things. Now hopefully you'll remember how we did the roof, how we did that brown by error, because we'll sort that out, because we need to make more of it on purpose this time, so hopefully it'll work. So if you remember, make your purple out of your crimson and your ultramarine. But we want a bit more, let's get my little flat brush again. You want a bit more crimson in your purple mix. And then add some cadmium yellow. And that should give us a nice orangey brown that we can use for our roof. If you really struggle, just use brown. Don't make make life difficult or stressful for yourself. It's a painting. While it's nice to learn skills, we don't want to get stressed about it so that we're not enjoying the process. So if you struggle to mix this brown, so a lot of crimson, a bit of ultramarine to make a purple, then add cadmium yellow incrementally. I've run out right in the middle of my roof. Banana. We'll add a few highlights to this as well. Now if I add a bit of the plaster colour to my chimney colour, to my roof colour, sorry, I can probably make a decent chimney tone. We'll outline some bits and do what have you. So, we want slightly lighter brown, although it's almost as if the light is above but also slightly behind, because only the very top of the roof is in highlight, and that's why the shadows of the chimneys right forward. I'm going to need to make this lighter brown. But to make my lighter brown, I need to make the brown again. Yellow and purple. There are other ways we can make browns, but this is the way I'm making the brown today. And a bit of white. Might need a bit more white because it is very much a line. Here and here. So I'll do a few little short lines and let it kind of disappear down. I need even more white. So the colour will fade down a little, but it is kind of in shadow all of this side. But we'll still do it, and then we can add some darks in a minute. I did say I wanted this cottage done by 5:30, but it's looking a bit iffy. We'll let that dry for a minute. We will get some blackout for this next bit, I think. We want to use it quite sparingly. While that's drying, if I go with the black, I can use it. I mix a little bit of ultramarine with it. Can use it to mark where my windows are. I'm just using the brush width actually to give me the shape of the windows. All of these windows, I was expecting them to be opposites, but actually they're all exactly the same window. Weird. I can always use a gel pen or something. There's probably windows and all sorts there, but we're going to shove a tree in front of it, so we don't really worry. Add a bit of purple colour to my black and start going underneath the eaves. maybe a slightly darker line right underneath. You could blend that line in with the colour. If you've got a damp brush, you see, it'll just blend it together nicely. Fiddle with my chimney stacks, and I'm going to do that with just black. Cheating a little bit with a dark outline. Maybe I'll use some of this shadow colour just to do a few dark lines in the roof to give it a bit of texture. Yeah, that'll work, won't it? I don't think the Tate will be calling up asking for it in their collection. But it is what it is. Maybe a little bit of white just on the stack. I really don't know what I've done to this brush, but it's horrible. Working with, oh, it is 1:30, that's good. So while you're finishing that off, I'll go and pop the kettle on here, and then we can really work on the purples and the greens and that nice little biscuity colour of the field there. So we're back in about 5 minutes.
Because I don't know how many you'll need for the surprises. But I can show you where all the other new things are.
Yeah, I was trying to do it like a cylinder.
What was it?
Like a wheel thing. So I'm having my doing all the portrait with those bits of canvas and the oil. Make your own family with like silk and crowns and gems.
Right. We'll use that dark green still for the bushes in front. Using the light green, I might end up using a little bit of black. So this is the dark green from ultramarine and cad yellow. And then I'll add a little bit of black because the light is behind it, don't forget. In front of it, rather. No, behind it, yeah. You could always use that lemon yellow ultramarine highlight as well, right on the tops, just to really hone it in that this is the light is in front. Well, behind, it's behind Barry. We're in front. Using a mixture of the two greens just to do some bushy things in front of some of these houses. Just a little bit, nothing too crazy. We'll let that dry. And let that dry. So we need quite a mucky, browny, creamy colour for the field. Just a little patch there. So that's a lot of cadmium yellow. A bit of that purple colour for the roof, the purpley brown. And kind of a straw colour, isn't it? Bit of white, and again I'm using a flat brush to block it in. And then a little brush to do the dotty bits. white. So it stands out a little bit more. That dry. We'll work on a little bit of purple next. So you want to make your purple. From your crimson and your ultramarine, I'm going to use, there's one area that is actually quite just a strip. Purple, so we're going to stick that in. There is going to be a few dotty bits above it. You could actually use a bit more neat cadmium yellow on your little bit of sort of straw colour in front of it. Brush across the room and a few dotty bits of purple. Not much, it's not as high as the yellow bits. It's different plant, isn't it? You don't want everything to look exactly the same, because it'll just look like you've got the same plant but in a different colour, and this is not that. You can see how the white plaster, well, the creamy plaster walls that we put on originally, now actually look paler because we've isolated the colour around darker tones. Get back neat cad yellow just to do a few little dots where the light could possibly be hitting them. I don't know. Brighten that up quite substantially. Right, we'll let that dry. I need to find my stipply brush out, my old manky brush. See that one? Yes. Because that's going to be useful for this bit. If you've got an even larger manky brush, you'll find that useful to cover this area really quickly, because we've only got 40 minutes left. So, you need to, if you haven't made more purple, make more purple. Stipple, 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 and you can let that green show through. And this is coming right the way down to about here, and we'll highlight, so you can see why having a bigger brush would really help in this situation. As you stipple, twist your bristles. So it's all in a different direction. Otherwise, it'll just be like the same shape all over. So just rock your brush between your finger and your thumb. The green through it is fine, that's what we're fine with. Because it's got green through it, because it's lavender's got stalks. You might add some slightly lighter green in the foreground, but really it's just a lot of blobby lavender, because we want to spend a good 10-20 minutes on the massive lavender in the foreground if we can get it right. We'll add some highlights onto this. So if you've got like a massive decorator's brush, you could have done this in 2 seconds. I don't know why I've gone into a middle bit like that, because it should be all over. Although there's actually more green on the right hand side than on the left. Try not to have as many gaps in the same places. And as I get lower down, look, I'm actually using the flat brush long ways, because that gives us even more of an effect of stems of lavender. Let that dry for a minute. And then we'll do a bit of white highlight with the purple. Little bits of green and then close up lavender. Right, that looks fairly dry in places to me. So I want some white and purple. Yeah, I know, it's crazy, isn't it? The screen's picks up the lighter tones way more than my eyeballs do. Might use some almost neat white. The trouble is, if you make your paint too runny, you lose the stipply bits, but you kind of need the stipply bits, and you need the paint to be opaque, but you need it to be fluid. There's so much with art, isn't there, that is annoying. And it's okay to be annoyed by it. I've been painting for a very long time and I still get annoyed by... I was chatting to a customer this morning about it, you know, with, especially like watercolours has a mind of its own, and you could do perfect dry brush technique, then an hour later, it's as if you've never done it before in your life. This gouache has got a little bit more control to it, but it just seems to stand out more on the telly. like that. He gone cold really quickly.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even cool today. I might actually use my scrubby brush to make a lemon yellow ultramarine mix and just flick it up like we would grass. And do the same with some darker green. It just saves us having to do loads of stalks. If you've got a comb or a rake brush, that's also a really good thing to do. You've got a customer. Ultramarine and cadmium yellow, just to start with. I'm leaving off a lot of pressure. By blocking it in this way, then I can do some slightly lighter greens. Something like that to start with. And then I'll have to make a slightly stronger mix. With potentially a little bit of white in this. The white always helps with opacity. Was it there just now? It's not off a wet label off your jacket or anything. Of green through the lavender. I might not go as crazy with the big ones, only because it's actually much more difficult to do because they're out of focus and we can't make it out of focus. It doesn't quite work with what we do. doing like long grassy sticky things. I might do some really dark ones of this with more ultramarine and card yellow. Now, I'll let that dry for a sec. Let's see how we go. The foreground's always the tricky bit because it's always a lot of nothing. I mean, in this case, it's not a lot of nothing, it's just humongous lavender. But I'm not going to make it as big. I might have as many, but I'm not going to have them as big because it works as a photograph, because our brains know it's a photograph, but as a painting it'll just look like alien giant lavender stems, which isn't really what we want. If you look at the lavender, it's clusters of flowers on one stem. So we should be able to do that. We did a painting, I think it must have been on two Monday evenings ago. And it was a very yellow field and a purple field, and then grasses at the front. but I actually made the grasses at the front go through horizon line, and it, even though it was just really short, like I've painted it here. But doing the grasses through the horizon line made a massive difference to how it looked. So I'm actually going to mix a bit of black with the green, and I know you think, oh, what's he doing? I don't know. But they've got to be dark, but I don't want it black. Not going to have it exactly like it is in the picture, because I don't want it like that. Call me a rebel. Like that. Stop. And then I will be mixing I'll be using my purple colour with my 1/8 of an inch brush, and each brush dab will be a blob of flower on each stem. So I'll probably do about 8. They kind of come in clusters. If you think of it like a fountain or a tier, you've got tiers of lavender flowers or buds. So you have a bit along the top, tiny gap, bit along the middle bit, then a tiny gap, then a bit more, then a bit more. So you think of it as tiered, it will make it look a little bit more realistic, even though we're not after photorealistic blobs of lavender. I'm not, anyway. Gouache is always more illustrative for me. I enjoy a more illustrative style in gouache, and maybe a bit more of a realistic style in others. So if you're really into landscapes and portraits and animals, you may find yourself mixing up more purples than you think. So get a dioxazine violet and it'll just save you mixing tons of colour. It really is a lifesaver. I might put a little bit of white gel pen around each blossom. Or at least some white paint with a hint of purple on it, I think. It could end up looking like grape hyacinth at the end, but don't matter. If I call it Cotswold lavender, then people will go, oh, it's lavender. It's not grape hyacinth. Like, it looks just like grape hyacinth. for a minute. So if I go with a smaller brush, maybe a little bit of crimson in with the purple and a substantial amount of white. The crimson just pinks it up a little bit more. Highlight, show what's in front, what's behind, because there's flowers all over, isn't there, really, with lavender. Could do it with neat white as well, because sometimes you might find that this is losing some of them. So don't go everywhere with it. But I'll probably just do a few little loops and swirls within this and then go with a white gel pen around the strongest areas of contrast. Because I've kind of lost some of these. As it was drying, I was losing them anyway. But because you've got a lavender field in front behind it, and you're actually painting lavender in the same colour as the lavender field, it's not going to be the same, is it? Well, you know, you're not going to have a huge amount of contrast. But let's let that dry for a minute. Some dark bits back on this one. I think I went a bit too crazy with my outline. There's only the few that are actually hit with the light will be pale. If you really needed to, you could make your purple tone darker with a bit of black, but that's need to be careful that you don't lose the purpleness, because then that's no longer lavender, is it? Just black flowers. Do you know what? I don't know if I do need to do any gel pen. Yeah, I think I don't want to add any more to this. I'm pleased with how it comes. As it's drying, it's looking quite nice. Next Wednesday, we're doing a sunflower and a blue sky, which should be quite nice to do. I'll probably do that on blue paper, on the blue-grey denim paper instead. I will, of course, take a photograph of this when it's totally dried so you can see how it comes out. But the camera has emphasised the white more than on the screen. There's not really a way of changing how it looks. It just is what it is. But you'll see when you see the photograph anyway what it looks like. But I have decided to make the lavender much darker, and it does make a difference. But I wanted the cottage to be as much of a focus as the lavender, whereas in the photograph, the foreground lavender is the focal. Now, if I'd got another hour and I'd got lavender to hand, I could really go to town with making an amazing study of some lavender. But as we've said, the house is in focus, but the lavender isn't in the photograph. Whereas when we're painting, everything will end up being in focus, which will look a little bit odd. So by doing smaller lavender, it kind of works better with the scene. So thank you so much for your company today. I look forward to seeing what you've created. Whenever it is you do this. And it's been quite relaxing, hasn't it, doing this lavender? Lavender is a relaxing plant, so that makes sense. So have a really good week. Look after yourselves. Take care. And I'll see you all again soon. Bye-bye, everybody. Bye-bye.